680's Richard Southern joins us now. And Richard, you're looking into that report from the Ontario Budget Watchdog that found that the Liberal Hydro plan has a $21 billion net cost. So we reported on this a couple of weeks ago, and now the FOAO office just confirming what we've already told you.
Yeah, it's quite something. And I think there's two main takeaways. But first, just a quick recap. France's financial accountability officer said the Liberal government will spend $45 billion over the life of its hydro plan to save people $24 billion. And the cost is mostly associated with funding this 8% rebate in hydro bills that started to take effect in January. Now, the watchdog today said if the government has to fund this rebate through debt, the cost of the province could balloon to $93 billion. So the big concern, first of all, I think, is what this is going to mean for a province that's already heavily in debt. Ontario's deficit projected to be $312 billion this year, about $22,000 for every Ontarian. And, you know, if this continues to weigh on the overall debt, you might see a credit downgrade, which would cost the province even more than to fund its red ink. The other takeaway is average hydro bills will continue to start rising until 2028. So what's that mean? Going to mean, Francis, for industry? Would you build a factory in Ontario knowing that you're going to have higher hydro rates going forward, or would you look at another province or a U.S. state instead? So the impact to Ontario's economy, I think, pretty great as a result of this hydro plan.
Yeah, absolutely. And the point to take away here is, yeah, hydro bills are going down in the short term, but really that's going to be short term, and they're expected to shoot up and quite sharply there.
Yeah, about 6.8% a year, I think he said today, until 2028. So again, tough for homeowners and tough for businesses, because these factories in Ontario, which we need, they're going to use a lot of power, and this could prevent them from expanding, I think.
Let's talk about Bitcoin now, because, you know, we heard a lot about it when it first came out and it was so valuable. Then it kind of disappeared and went away and wasn't so valuable. But now here it is again, shot up. What's going
on? It's back. Bitcoin going bananas, Francis. The price right now, if you want to buy one Bitcoin, it's going to set you back $3,300 Canadian, about $2,500 U.S. Yes. Over $3,300 Canadian dollars for one Bitcoin. It has doubled in value in the past 2 months. It's moved about $500 higher since Saturday, and it's getting a lot of attention. It's being more accepted as an actual currency. Japan just recently recognized Bitcoin as a legal payment method. The other thing that might be at play is the rise in Bitcoin in the last 2 months has come at the same time the Chinese stocks have moved lower, and the theory is that the search among Chinese investors for a safe haven has led many people into Bitcoin. So it's a red-hot currency again, and yeah, $3,300 Canadian for one of those Bitcoins.
Can you use it to buy a house in Toronto?
You're going to need a lot of Bitcoins, even at this rate, I think.
You sure will. But the Bank of Canada actually left the interest rate where it is, status quo.
Yeah, and I think the housing story really plays into what the bank did today. So the interest rate unchanged. And I think the bank, you know, is really reluctant to raise rates, even though the Canadian economy is doing better. We had that story just yesterday here on City News about the majority of homeowners probably unable to withstand even a 1% interest rate hike because it would send mortgages up. The Bank of Canada today, though, did open the door to a possible rate hike maybe later this year or next year that supported the loonie. So, yeah, the Canadian economy doing better, growing at 4.7% in the first quarter, but the bank pretty much unable to raise interest rates at this point, Francis.
So there's an interesting story out there saying that the lack of sleep actually reduces economic growth. So you're looking into who gets enough Z's and maybe some of the bedtime habits of the world's most successful people?
Yeah, here are a group of successful people, and we have what they do just before they go to bed. So maybe we can garner something from this, Francis. First off, Michael Phelps, that decorated Olympian swimmer, he climbs into an altitude chamber. But of course, right? It mimics high altitude, helps his muscles work harder. I'm going to give that one a try. Mariah Carey, the singer, she surrounds herself with humidifiers, and that helps, you know, add moisture to the air. She says she sleeps
15. It's not helping her voice these days, let me tell you. But
not
anyway.
These days. She says she sleeps 15 hours a day. Elon Musk, he's the CEO of two companies, and he's trying to cut back on caffeine, he says, before he goes to bed, because he's claimed to drink 8 cans of Diet Coke and 2 cups of coffee every day. So he's trying to cut back on that.
8 cans of Diet Coke.
Hey, he runs two companies, you know? He needs the caffeine. Oprah Winfrey meditates. She even has her own meditation app. And I guess it's easy to be Zen when you're one of the richest people people in the world. Bill Gates says he reads for an hour before he goes to bed, no matter how late it is, and he manages to get through a book every week. That might make you successful. Finally, Kenneth Chenault, he is the CEO and chairman of American Express, and he says he creates a list of three things he wants to accomplish the next day just before he goes to bed. So maybe we can garner some things from that. I'll try the high altitude chamber myself.
Yeah, what I garner from that is those people don't have three little kids at home, dinner to make.
They have a lot of time on their
hands. They don't come home late from work. They have
a lot of time for meditation.
Yes.
Absolutely.
No kidding. Thank you, Richard.
Thanks.
We'll see you tomorrow.